Listening to Patty Valentine from the upper hall. She sees the bartender in a pool of blood. Cries out, my God, they've killed them all.
Here comes the story of the hurricane. The many authorities.
Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining me and my special guests, the stars from the Broadway musical Girl from the North Country. Please say hello to Jeanette Bayardelle and Marc Kudisch. How are you both?
I can't hear you.
Oh, you can't hear me now?
I can't hear anything. Let me see. I don't know.
I can hear everything.
I can't hear.
It says the host has just unmuted everybody. Can you hear now?
Can you hear now, Beth? Jeanette?
I don't know what to do. Should I? Let me.
Don't you love technology? I just love it. Yep. I love the learning curve we're all going through with this stuff.
I love it. Mark, can you hear me?
Oh, yeah, I can hear you great.
Well, first of all, thank you for joining me. I think. Hey,
Jeanette,
can you hear me?
I can hear, yes.
Boom.
It's all about resetting. So that's really cool. Thank you for joining me today. Seriously. You know, first of all, how are the two of you and where are the two of you?
I'm great. I'm in my house in Rockland County. You know, I'm staying home, ordering groceries and just staying home so that we can get back as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Good. And Mark,
healthy
where
here,
are you?
Healthy and safe. Thankful for that. And my wife, Shannon, and I, and our dog, are in our apartment, New York City, North Corner, Central Park West. I am so grateful daily for Central Park. I am so grateful for it. And I'm grateful for our dog because he's the reason that we get outside. Other than that, just like Jeanette said, we are in, we are masked, we are disinfecting daily. We are treating this as though we have the virus ourselves.
Absolutely, that's how you gotta be.
Yep.
Because the quicker we do that, the quicker we get out of this whole thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and it's also not just about you, right? It's not just about I'm healthy. It's got to be about everybody else being healthy as well. Mm-hmm. So that's why I just think that the more we behave like we can infect others, the quicker we will all be done with this, like Jeanette said.
Yeah.
You know, the last time I saw both of you was on your wonderful opening night of March 5th.
Yeah.
What a glorious night that was. And then 7 days later, Broadway shut down on March 12th. What was that day like for both of you? And how did you both find out?
Well, for me, I was on the couch. I was on the couch watching Cuomo talk about it. I was that one in the cast, like I said before, who was like preparing for this since February. I'm like telling the cast, like, guys, I think Broadway's going to shut down. And they're like, Jeanette, would you stop? That would never happen. Stop. And I'm like, no, I'm telling you, I'm watching the news and I'm following this thing and we're going to shut down. And so I was prepared. So that day I was actually watching to see like, are they going to shut it down today? Like, when is this going to happen? Because I know that this thing is serious. So I was pretty much prepared. I was sitting there watching. And when it happened, I was like, oh, all right. And then we went to the theater to collect some stuff and I saw Mark and we were talking about it again. So I was pretty prepared. And I feel like the cast, because it was something that we were talking about even the night before,
right.
I believe a couple of cast members, we were like, I heard that it's going to happen tomorrow or something like that, and we're like, wait, what? So we were prepared for it mentally, I guess, because we had been talking about it,
right?
So
yeah, don't you remember? I remember, as you said, Richard, I know for a lot of people, their last social event that they were at was our opening, because we were the last to open. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this time of the year, everyone's opening, right? So that just happened to be the opening of the moment. And it was a beautiful opening. And we had worked so hard to get it on its feet. And we finally were there. And it was a great night. We all had a ball. And then the next day we were called for a meeting, right, Jeanette? We were called for a meeting with our producers. Yes. And of course they were like, nothing bad, you know, because the opening was great. We just need to talk about this coronavirus threat that is now becoming present. And I remember I said right off the bat, do you remember, Jeanette? I said right off the bat, what's the plan for when we close? Because it's mm-hmm. going to happen. And of course at that time, and I think this was a big part of it, and this wasn't to take away from anybody, but like our producers are like, we're not planning on closing. We're planning on moving forward. We're planning on running. And I understood that, but I was sort of like, yeah, but we're going to have to.
Yeah.
At some point, we're going to have to. So what's the plan in place for that? And I just think that it happened way sooner than anyone expected it to. I had thought maybe we're a couple weeks out to a month out at that time. And Jeanette was on this from February. But it was interesting because I think, look, we all were sort of kind of caught in a moment where we weren't prepared. But I'm so happy that Cuomo did what he did and continues to do what he did. I'm really happy we closed down hard and fast that way.
Yeah.
You know, I know it affected all of us, and we're living through what will be our new normal. But If that hadn't happened, who knows what mire we'd be in right now?
Yeah. What's a typical day like for you now? Because, you know, we're going into the second month, and I think the hardest thing for a lot of people was how to fill their day and how to make one day different from the next. That was, you know, right. I've spoken to a lot of people here, and that's what they were trying to add structure to their day-to-day life. What's a day-to-day like for each of you?
Well, I get up, depending on when I get up, it's usually in the afternoon because my nights are, I mean, it's like there's no time here, but so
yeah.
I get up in the afternoon, so this is early for me, and then I do yoga because I got to get my body right and my mind focused and just like, because we're in this different space, so I feel like that calms me, but I spend a lot of my day on the guitar. I've been playing a lot of guitar. My fingers are actually so sore from playing, but I spend mm-hmm. a lot of days on the guitar. And FaceTiming with family and friends, and at some point I had to stop talking corona because it becomes too much. So I had to tell like my sisters, like, listen, no more text messages. I don't want to hear any more sad stories right now because I can't. Just give me the basics. Give me the stuff I need to know if something changes. But sometimes it's just too much. You know what I mean? So I try to stay just focused, grounded. This environment is my environment of peace. Because I know so much is going on outside, and I have to stay grounded because I don't want to be like this all day. So I just try to stay grounded, keep my environment peaceful, and just try to get through this the best way I can.
Yeah. Marc, for you, what are your days like?
It's funny because I find that even in all of this, there's not enough time in the day, strangely. But I think Shannon and I sort of quickly fell into a routine and a schedule of sorts. And because we have a dog, that was the part of it, you know? So like we worked it out so that like I take the dog out in the morning for an hour, she'll take the dog out for an hour in the afternoon. And then that way each of us, and then I'll take the dog out again for an hour around 6 o'clock. And then that gives each of us space to be able to work on stuff if we want to work on stuff. Like, because I have other projects. I know you too do, Jeanette. Mm-hmm. I have other projects that have been on a back burner because of opening the show. And like right before this, I did The Great Society. So like there's been no time to even focus on anything else because I've just done nothing but be in previews opening. So it's sort of nice to have time to be able to refocus on those things. So part of it's been that, part of it's been training the dog. We have a puppy, so it's been nice to really be able to have this time in his life right now, to go to the park, to do the training, to you know, like really socializing correctly. I don't know, man. It's been like yoga, a lot of yoga. Oh my God, a lot of yoga. And I got to be honest with you. And here's the thing. Like, I just asked friends of mine this morning. Concerned and thoughtful of everyone that has been gone through this, that has had the illness, that has had to fight it, that has lost people that they love. Friends of ours in this industry that we know that have been fighting this virus and continue to fight this virus. And I feel for them, and I want everyone to be healthy. On the other side of this is this strange gift of being forced into an environment where you're able to focus in a different way and actually see a lot of positives. You know, there are things from this that, like I said, if what are the positives that you're going to take away from this thing, even when it's over and we go back to our normal, what are the things you're going to take with you from this? Because I know there are quite a few things that I'm not leaving behind. Time, living day to day, as opposed to thinking about 5 weeks from now, a month from now, 5 months from now, what's the game plan? I love this. There is no game plan.
Yeah,
you have to be present day to day to day to day. It's super nice.
And I think that we also have to, what I've learned was to like be easy on myself, because I'm a planner. So I'm always planning for the future. Like, okay, so I have to have this in order, that in order, and this is what I have to do. But it's like, I'm giving myself a chance to just breathe.
Yeah.
Relax and not feel like I have to occupy my entire day with planning for the future. You know, so I'm just taking this time to like breathe, relax, assess the situation, because, you know, you can plan all day, clearly, and, you know, things don't quite work out. So I feel like in this season, it's like I have to take it one day at a time, one step at a time. What are we doing now? Right now, we're staying home.
Yeah.
We have food on the table. And so I have to focus on that for now, and just things to just lift my spirits. Because we don't know when this is going to end. We don't know how this is going to end or what the real effect of it is going to be. So you can plan and plan, but it's like, you know, what are you planning for? I'm not saying not plan, but I know me, because I am a planner, I had to like, just like relax. It's like, Jeanette, calm down, relax. So I'm being easy.
But there's something so beautiful just about being present right now, right? Like, I don't know if I'm like, I'm in great shape. Right now, I'm feeling super healthy because of like yoga and because of having space. And Jeanette, I don't know about you, but like, I needed a break. I needed a minute.
We did. And I mean, like, we came off of like 12 hours a day from January. Yeah. It was like, we did a lot. We did.
Like a lot. And so like, there's just something, I mean, and the appreciation of the fact that the air is clean, that the earth in general is taking a big sigh of relief right now.
Yeah.
You know, my buddies out in LA are like, the air in Los Angeles right now is the cleanest that it's ever been on record. And like, my buddies are like, I'm smelling fresh air for the first time. And I don't know, there's something, I hope that people take a certain quality of life with them into the new normal, so that we don't lose some of what is good about this experience. I could do without the sickness. I think we could all do without the sickness, but there's other stuff about this. I've talked to friends that I haven't talked to in such a long time. And like, you know, now there's the time to do it. And it's sort of a joy. Like my, you know, Shannon and I have been like, you know, meeting with friends every night. It's actually been kind of crazy busy in some weird way. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I think, like you said, it's about connecting. That's the one thing that everyone has done. Everyone takes a breath. It's like when you talk to someone, you're really talking to them. It's not like you're thinking about, like you said, Jeanette, what's going to happen tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's like, I think we're going back to friends of mine who live in Italy said the canals are all clean. There are like swans. And I mean, it's like you said, your friends in LA, the air is clean. It's like you stop all of this stuff, the pollution and all of this stuff, and the world sort of goes back to what it was. Mm-hmm. I think it'd be very interesting, all of our first night back. I mean, I cannot wait to see your show again. I mean,
right.
Your show is unlike any other show there is. I want to talk a little bit about your show because, you know, I think I told you both this. Growing up, I really didn't have a connection to Bob Dylan because I was brought up on cast albums. Mm-hmm. You know, but watching what Connor McPherson and Bob Dylan, the combination of them together, let's talk about the brilliance of what Connor has done with this music and putting the show together.
He is just, we love Connor and Bob Dylan. It is just amazing. He's an amazing storyteller, just like Bob Dylan. So I feel like the marriage of the two is perfect. The way that he's written the story and the way that he's included the music is like none other. There's nothing like our show. And not only is it good storytelling, but it's great art visually. Yeah. It's just amazing to watch. I mean, when I've seen like video footage, I'm like, wow, the lighting, the way the story is told. And I feel like now even more than ever, our story will resonate with people because of what's going on. This is about a bunch of boarders who are going through something and they're trying to figure out how to make it work, how they're going to get their meal. And it's, as you know, it takes place during a depression. So I feel like more now than ever, people can relate to this story. And I look forward to the day when we open up again and we do the show.
It'll be interesting to see how we all come back to it too.
Yeah.
I like you said, Rich, it's going to be interesting to see where all of our heads are coming back to the piece and how, like, getting back into the play and how we're affected before and after. And, you know, it's weird because if you didn't know the piece, you would think this piece was written as a response to all of this. Mm-hmm. And of course, it's not. Which just tells you a couple things. One, everything is cyclical because this is about the depression. And we keep coming around and around. And when Dylan wrote this music, you know, Dylan was under the wing of Woody Guthrie and the spirit of the troubadour, that traveling musician who was speaking out with protest about the things that they felt were wrong. And, it's why Dylan's music, I think, works so beautifully with Connor's construction. Mm-hmm. We love Connor. God bless the Irish. Yeah. Just God bless the Irish. The way they tell story, it's an amazing thing. Because I'm working on this other piece, too. I'm beginning to work on this new opera, again, written by an Irish librettist and composer. And the way that they're so blunt and sort of unprecious in their dialogue and in their play structure, and then when music comes in, that's the release of everything. That's why I think it works so beautifully with Dylan's music to Connor's writing. And Connor has said it to us constantly. It's that, you know, the play is brutal and unforgiving, and it's in the music that you get that release, because you don't get that release within the play, which is why, as well, the play needs the music, because you can't have one without the other. And, you know, it's beautiful, and it is unlike anything else I've ever done. That's for sure, at the very least. Wow. So I mean, we're lucky. Our cast stays in touch. We always have. Yeah. So we talk to each other often. We have great producers. Tristan is a remarkable guy. And we have meetings, and we have another meeting coming up this afternoon. So I'm going to see you in just a little bit again.
He'll be back. Okay. Mark will be back. Technically, I mean, you've been connected. Like, you talk to the cast a lot, right, Jeanette? Yeah, tell me how you all stay connected.
We have Zoom meetings. Well, when we opened at the Public, which was a year ago, is it over a year now? We stayed connected. So we've been texting. We've been family for like a year, just texting each other. But we have like challenges just via our text. We have like this Bob Dylan challenge where we have to sing a Bob Dylan song and play an instrument if you know how. So, but we don't do it on like social media, but we have it within our group text. Yeah. So it's fun. We do a couple of things like that. Like it's just been a joy staying connected with them. It definitely brightens my day every day that I see somebody post something in the group chat, which is always usually funny and interesting.
Because Mark, you were asking, staying connected with the company, what that has meant to you.
Oh, well, I mean, it's everything. It's our family, though. you know, a lot of times, and you hear it, you'll always hear it. I'm sure you've heard it from other people that are in shows and stuff. You become a our show is about a group of people that over the course of 2 or 3 weeks become this makeshift family. And every company of a play or musical is a makeshift family. So it's sort of meta in some ways, but in our particular case, we really have become very close and we are a family. You know, because I keep in touch with a bunch of people, like even before all of this happened, we all kept in touch.
Yeah.
You know, so it means a lot to stay in touch because, you know, that connection is just a part of why we're doing this to begin with. And now we're all so dispersed. Like that was the thing. I don't know about you, Jeanette. That was the thing that sort of caught me the first time we all sort of got on and we did that Zoom chat with each other. Yeah. Who was it that called it? Was it Mayor that said, hey, let's Zoom.
Oh yeah. I'm not sure who called it, but that first day, that first Zoom meeting was pretty great.
It was great. And it wasn't too long after everything had like shut down. I think maybe it was even just a week after we had shut down, but to see where everyone had gone. Cause like, I was like, I had no idea where people were, and Mayor's in Connecticut, and, you know, Todd and his husband, Mark, are up in Maine. And I was like, wow. Like everyone just like, wow. Everyone like, so many of us just took off and like went distance, not a short distance. And I was just sort of like, whoa, where is everybody? Whoa. And it was the first, like, it was this weirdness of, because we had all just spent every day of our lives together for so long. And I knew that Colton had headed out to Kentucky because I was just like texting with him about some other stuff. And he was like, dude, we're heading to Kentucky. And I was like, oh, wow, okay. And then he literally said to me, like, they got in the car and they got there in like no time to Lexington, Kentucky from New York, because he said there's no one on the roads. And like,
did it hit you right away? Because like I said, you know, you're on this train ride from going from like, you know, tech rehearsals, changes, previews, an incredible opening. You got incredible reviews for your show. You start your second week and all of a sudden it's pulled away from you. And like you said, everybody scurried. Like when you got home, you were like, were you able to process it right away?
Well, let me tell you, someone who's been preparing since February, meaning I've been shopping. I mean, by the time.
She's not kidding. That's, I know. Yeah.
So by the time we shut down, what was that, March 12th?
Yeah.
On March 13th, I went to go to the store to get just a couple of things. And I'm wearing my mask and everything. People looking at me like I'm crazy at this point, but I didn't care.
Yeah,
you're right.
By March 13th, I had everything I needed and I'm home. And it hit me hard. And this is someone who's been preparing.
Yeah.
Because when you're preparing, you know, you're going to get stuff. So you're still acting. But when everything stops and you're like, this is what it is.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a hard pill for me to swallow. So it took me a couple of days, like that night, the night after we closed out, that's when I felt it most. I was like, wow, like this is really happening. And it took me a while to like, just like rebuild my spirit, because it hit me like, this is it. This is what I've been preparing for. And here we are. So it was definitely a shock. And I'm someone who has been preparing. So I can't imagine for someone who didn't even think about it. And it just happened like that. I can't even imagine what that would have been like.
Mark, for you two, with you and Shannon, what was it like?
Well, I have to say that Shannon has like Jeanette's sort of spirit in her. Like Shannon was like preparing in a way that I wasn't. And I think a part of that was just, I was just so exhausted. I'm not going to lie. Yeah. I was just tired. So the idea of preparing for something when I was just preparing to have a break. But she had prepped us. We had stored up on some food and stuff. She had actually ordered masks when they were saying it's not necessary. And I was like, all right, let's get masks. If you think, I mean, sure. You know, and of course she was right. She was right. You know, and Jeanette was right. And it didn't hit first. I'm not going to lie. I actually was just happy to have a long weekend. Yeah. So there was that initial part of me that was like, because we were just chugging along like this, and I was supposed to start a workshop like a week after we opened, So I was so tired, and I was already trying to prepare myself to go back to rehearsal after just coming out of it. I'm not complaining. I'm just saying that was what was weighing on me. Of course, that is completely superfluous now. But there was that part of me that was just almost happy to just not have to do anything. So it wasn't until the next week that we got into the next week. Because even the day after, that Thursday, that Friday, I had an audition. And I was like, really? Really? And it was for a voiceover. So I went. And who do I run into? Danny Burstyn. So I saw Danny the day after we all shut down. Danny was great. Danny looked great. Danny was feeling great. We were sitting there chatting, going into the audition, just saying, this is crazy, right? And we were just talking about, you know, it's nuts. How are you guys doing? At this point, Aaron knew he wasn't feeling well. Yeah. So, you know, I was like, yeah, you know, we'll see soon. You know, keep feeling healthy. The thing that really hit me was when I found out not even a week later that Danny was sick. And that was the thing I think that hit me in some way, because I was like, I just saw him. Mm-hmm. And if it's hitting Danny, who is a machine, right?
Yeah.
I mean, God bless him. I don't know how he still can like churn it out like that. Like, I can't churn it out like that anymore. Like, I can't do those. Like, he is just that kind of role that is just like, pow, out of the gate every time. And the fact that he was down for the count the way that he was, that was when I got hit with the idea of, it doesn't matter how old you are.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't matter who you think you are. It doesn't matter how healthy you may be. Obviously, those are factors, but anyone can get hit by this thing because no one's quite sure of how it functions yet. And that was when I, yeah.
And you know what's interesting? I was one of those, my cast knows, but I was very sick in February.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I never get sick, never, ever lose my voice, ever. I was sick. Mm-hmm. I lost my voice. And I could not shake this thing. And I'm like, I went to the doctor. I'm telling you, because you know I'm a preparer and I don't play. I went to the doctor seven times. Seven. Like, I kept going back like, no. So they had to put me on two antibiotics, prep, all kind of stuff. And it was so terrible what I went through. Yeah. And that was when I ordered masks for the first time. It was like the end of January, because I was like, this, whatever this is, I don't know what this is. And it took me all of February to finally get back to 100. So honestly, when I went to the doctor in January, early February, I literally was like, well, could you test me for coronavirus? And they were like, girl, there's no coronavirus here. I'm like, no, but I'm telling you, I was following it so early. But I thank God, I mean, I had a flu test, it wasn't the flu or anything like that, but thank God I got better and I recovered. I got my voice back after almost a month. I mean, I struggled even through previews. So yeah. I felt like I took it a little more serious because I had gotten sick with something, whatever it was, and I'd never gotten sick before. So it was very serious to me because I'm like, no, this thing right here, if what I got is that thing, you don't want this.
Yeah.
So I felt like I took it extra serious because I had gotten sick at the end of January. So, my heart goes out to people who are dealing with the sickness. And then the psyche, because I'm sure everybody at home has been like, am I sick? Oh my God, let me take my temperature. And we were on Broadway in the middle of it. You understand what I'm saying? When you see those numbers, you're like, oh my God. I mean, we've definitely come across people who've had it or been interacting. So I'm checking the first 2 weeks, I was checking my temperature twice a day.
Yeah.
Like I was staying on it because I knew that you have to stay on this thing and do what you have to do. So I was taking my temperature twice a day. And then finally I'm like, okay, I guess, you know, and then I'm like, well, what if I had it before? And that's not all these things going through your head. You become a doctor, you become your psychiatrist, your psychologist, like you become all these things to yourself. And it's just been a journey.
Yeah.
It's a journey.
But the thing is, look, we all know when you're opening a show or when you're previewing a show this time of year, everybody gets sick. Mm-hmm. Always. It's winter to spring. You're exhausted. Your defenses are down. You're working 8 shows a week, rehearsing in the day. Everyone gets sick. before we even knew about the coronavirus, the big thing going around town was, if you know anyone in the workshop of the Music Man, stay away from them.
Yes.
Because they're really sick right now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's always the thing. You know how it is. People get a flu and then it goes through a company because we work together that way. So I cannot believe that we did not brush the coronavirus while we were working on Broadway. I cannot believe we didn't brush it here or there, because it was already present. Now we know that. And we're working, and it doesn't matter how much you're cleaning your hands. And we were cleaning our hands backstage. We had sick cast members, and everyone's just thinking, I have a cold, I have the flu, I have my allergies.
Yeah.
I'm sure someone had it. I cannot, in our company, I'm sure of it. Now I'm sure of it. But like, I'm not sure that I didn't actually have a very, very mild version of it. And like, you know, Jeanette just said, you can't help but become your own doctor in that situation and circumstance. Mm-hmm. But like, you know, there's not a lot. We did what we could.
Yeah.
We
but
did
I also
what
love
we could.
Your, yeah. I also love your honesty, Marc, because everyone I've had on my show since this, everybody said the first few days I just slept because my body was so tired of just getting my show up and happening. And then they were able to process what was happening.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And I keep processing it.
It's so funny because of the way that I think. Because I mean, opening night, literally, I'm like, oh my God, we're going to this party. Corona. Yeah. Oh Jesus. Oh God, here we go. So you're in the party, like, here we go, God protect me. You know, and I feel bad because that was that cloud. So you couldn't really, well, for me. I tried to put it out my head, but as I'm looking at everybody, and it's crowded, and we're partying, and we're celebrating. All I could think of is, oh my God, oh God, okay, one more time, protect me, God. You know what I mean? So I do feel like, I don't want to say I was robbed of the full joy of it, but I had that over my head, thinking like we're celebrating, we're hugging each other, and you know, and I'm just like, oh man, here we go. You know,
so you're a really good actress, because I spoke to you that night and I saw none of this. So it might have been going on in your head, but boy, you're good.
You have to like put it out your head, because you go crazy. You'd be like, I'm not going to the party. But I was just like, no, this is our party. And hey, listen, this is what it is. And at that point, I was me and my brother who was here with me. He was here from California and he was with me. And we would have meetings the night before every night, just because he does like all my social media stuff, and we would have meetings and we would just go down this dark hole, and it's just like, and we were like, you know what, I think at this point everybody has corona, so it, listen, everybody has it at this point, so let me stop thinking we're gonna enjoy the party. Because that was the way I had to get through it, knowing that like this thing is out there, we're in the city, and
exactly.
So
I mean, the day that we all heard. I remember the day that we all heard that one of the ushers had it.
Yeah.
That was the day where it was like, boom, right? That was the day that even with Jeanette, like warning all of us, it was still the day that it was like, okay, it's clearly here. And there's clear evidence. And if it's in one theater, it's in every theater.
Yeah.
There's no way it's not in every theater in New York City right now. There's just no way. And
it was funny. It was funny because like a couple of weeks before we shut down, like I was going, like I went to stage management, the office. I'm like, listen, guys, please make another announcement about washing your hands. This is serious. And they're looking at me like, okay. And our stage manager's like, Jeanette, that was the day they went and bought hand sanitizer before it like all disappeared. Because I went and had, like, I was doing the most. I'm not going to lie. I even went to Connor. I was like, Connor, our director, I was like, Connor, listen. So what's the plan? Like, what if we close? And Connor's like, what are you talking about? Why would we be closed? I'm like, coronavirus. I mean, it's not funny, but it was it was such a concern of mine. And it got to the point where I would get to the theater and people would be like, Jeanette, what did you do today? And I'm like, oh, you know, I went grocery shopping, preparing. They're like, Jeanette, oh my goodness, girl, you are doing too much. And I wish I was wrong.
I'm sure everybody calls you now and says, what do you have? What do I need to get in my house,
The cast members, because I was telling the cast member, I said, you know what you need to get? This was like before the shutdown, anything. I said, get pancake mix that just adds water. I was like, store up on that just in case, you know, there's like food shortage. And she was like, I wouldn't, that's too many carbs, Jeanette. I would never. I'm like, okay. And then after we shut down, she called me. She's like, what should I buy? What should I get from the supermarket? I'm like, okay, this is what you get. And the toilet tissue thing was crazy because when I did my first run, like in February, I definitely got toilet tissue, but that wasn't a thing. And then came like this thing, and I'm like, thank God I got toilet tissue, but I wasn't thinking about it. It's just crazy how we respond to things and what's not on the shelf. It's just crazy.
And do we really need it? Are you cooking? Like, who are either of you chefs now in your house?
Well,
like, what are your culinary delights?
My mom is here with me. So my mom does a lot of cooking. Before my mom got here, I was cooking and stuff, but now that my mom is here, I'm very blessed.
So she does all the cooking in the house?
She does most of the cooking. Yeah, she does all of the cooking. Yeah, pretty much.
Are there like go-to meals? Like, mom, make this when I was growing up? I mean, what's mom making?
Well, last night I had her make rice and beans and fish. I'm Haitian American, so we loved our rice and beans. So I had rice and beans and fish. I don't eat meat, so, you know, she made me some rice and beans and fish, which was amazing. So I know I'm blessed to have her here with me. And I actually had to, she was in Virginia. And early on, I was like, okay, she needs to come home. She needs to come to me. And so I sent for her here. I had a car pick her up, because I'm like, you're not getting on the train, you're not getting on the plane. Like, I had a car service pick her up, and I was like calling the car service, like, is the car clean? Is your driver wearing a mask? Like, I did all of that. It was a great company. They brought her, even while she was here, I mean, I would not be downstairs without a mask. And I'm washing everything. And she's like, Jeanette, you're doing too much. No, it is like an army base in this house. Okay. There's a protocol. There's a strict protocol that I follow. She doesn't go outside at all. I get the mail, but to get the mail and packages, like, I suit up, gloves, mask, glasses.
We do too.
I suit up. Nothing comes in the house. I take it outside and then I bring it in and it sits. It's just like a whole process. But I wanted her to just be, I want my mom to be safe. So she doesn't have to worry about the outside world. I take care of all of that. But it's just, now that I started not necessarily wearing a mask, because it's been like a little over a month. So now I'm not necessarily, if I'll be in the same room with her without a mask, but we're never close. But for the first 20 days, I would say, like, I'm wearing a mask anytime I'm around her. And then I have other family members that are here, but they're in a whole different part of the house. I don't even see them. We social distance in the house. And that's what you have to do, because they still are working. So they don't have contact with us because we're home. So it's a process. Like, there's like, it's strict in here. It's an army base.
I love that. Mark, for you, like, cooking and like mail and all that stuff, what's happening? Who cooks in your house?
We both do.
Okay.
We both cook, and we've always cooked. I mean, so that's why, like, if I'm not in a show, the joy is always that we can cook, you know, like when we were between Great Society and when we went back to work, it was great because we had our evenings and we could actually cook. And then once you get into a show, there's just not the kind of time. You don't have time in the day, so you're having to eat out. And I'm not a fan of that, but we've always cooked. Like, we don't order in. So it's been great. Like, we have our regular, stuff that we go to that we like, and we know we've been trying some new recipes, a couple of which have been great, and we will keep doing. You know, that's the joke in the house, is just like, what are we gonna have for dinner? That's always like that's the biggest quandary of the day. You know, and like with mail, like again, like with what Jeanette said, we are pretty militaristic about going out, coming in. If I take garbage, you know, out down to the basement, suit up for it. We have our outdoor clothes and we have our indoor clothes. And the minute we come in, we take off the outdoor clothes and we hang them in our foyer. And then we have our indoor clothes. You know, when I take the dog out, we outdoor clothes. When we come in, things get sprayed and disinfected. The minute we come in, packages, anything from the grocery store gets wiped down. Mm-hmm. The dog gets wiped down, even though, you know, the information is that dogs don't really carry it. And I think that's the biggest part of it. I was going to say that before, like when we were at the theater and we were each doing our own thing and a lot of us were taken off guard. I'm just saying it. I'm just being honest. A big part of it is that we didn't have information and that we didn't have a focus on the potential of what this was. And that to me was the biggest challenge, not the virus itself, but information about the virus, procedure and execution of the procedure about the virus, which we now have, which is why I think in some ways that that panic has lifted because we have a stronger sense of it. And that's why everybody was out buying toilet paper, because everybody was panicking.
Yeah. But at the same time, we have this we have information, but we don't have all the information. And I knew early on that if they say 6 feet, you make that 20 feet for me. You understand? So even with me going out, I live at my neighborhood, there's pretty hardly nobody outside. But even when I go for walks, because I know we don't understand the disease, like we're masking up because we don't fully understand. And it's changing every day. So I feel like you kind of like have to do your research and figure out what makes sense. You know what I mean? So I know that, okay, they say you can't get it from going outside, taking a walk or whatever, but me, I'm gonna wear a mask when I go outside. But that's just me because I don't wanna get caught off guard.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean? So I feel like this is a situation where you have to really assess the situation for yourself and make decisions based on that. Because I come from a family, I have a lot of doctors. My dad's a doctor, my sister's a doctor, everybody, so many doctors and nurses in my family. And I feel like it was the doctors in my family that were having a hard time grasping what this was. But the ones who weren't necessarily, because they're trained a certain way. So the ones who weren't necessarily medical doctors, they were the ones that can grasp what was happening easier, because it's like, no, this is this. And the doctors are kind of like, oh, no, the CDC. And because you still believing in that, not to say don't believe in it, but this thing was, we didn't know about it. So I feel like a lot of doctors had a hard time. There were doctors online that were like, you don't need a mask. First of all, if you wear an N95 mask, it has to be sucked. The suction has to be proper. So you don't need a mask. I didn't listen to that. I was like, okay, that's what you'll do. But for me in my house, we're going to wear a mask. So I feel like it took doctors a harder time to grasp what this was because of their training. And it's like, you know, this is the information that was being put out there. But now they have to recant and say, you know what, you probably did need a mask.
But I will say this. I will say this to that. I think it depends on where you were in the whole crisis of it. Yeah. My sister, Sherry, runs a pathology lab at a hospital called the Cleveland Clinic down in South Florida in Fort Lauderdale, and it's a beautiful hospital. And she manages the histology and pathology lab down there. So she was on the front line of having to do all the studies on the blood and putting together the tests for the virus. And so I was hearing everything from her, and like, she was the one saying what you're saying, Jeanette. She was like, wear mask, do this.
For her, because of, but you have regular doctors that are like, no, are you, well, do you have a fever? You know what I'm saying?
Right. But that's because, again, it was about the information that we were receiving from the beginning. Yeah. And it was also about the pushback to the information that we were receiving from the beginning. Like you, I mean, I just think it's logical. Whether or not you think you need a mask, just wear one.
Yeah.
Like, what's the big deal? Like, when I go outside, because again, I'm out, I'm walking the dog. There are other dog owners out there. So actually, when I go out in the park, like this morning, because the weather is nice again, I mean, there were a lot of people in the park with their dogs. You know, I wear a jacket.
Yeah.
I wear a mask. I have my glasses on. So it's like, look, I know that I'm protecting every possible orifice for me to get this thing. And it's like, whether or not I need it, what the hell? Just wear it. Because you know that you're just taking,
but
you're taking a step.
Hard because you were wearing a mask and then people are looking at you like they said, don't wear a mask. And you're like, I don't care what they, so it was hard because people are staring like, oh my goodness, you don't know anything. Don't wear a mask. It's doing more damage. Just do, you know what I mean? So it was
hard. But that's why I said when we started wearing masks, I would just say to people, I'm just acting as though I have it, because the truth is, and this was the thing that people heard, I don't know if I'm carrying it or not. I could be right now. Like, that's the one piece of information that we got early on that I took to heart fast. We could be carrying it. It may not affect you the way that it affects other friends of ours.
Yeah.
You know, like I talked to Gavin and I talked to Gavin about like when he got the
Gavin virus, Creel,
how it impacted him. Yeah, Gavin Creel. And like, it was tough, but it wasn't terrible, but it definitely knocked him out for a minute.
Yeah.
You know, and then I talked to other people who had it that had no symptoms, that had no problems, and only found out that they had it because they were in for another test and they proved positive for it.
Sorry, that's me. They're delivering.
Oh, I thought you fell over.
They're delivering something. She's going and getting a delivery. I hope it's good.
Well, listen, we're just about out of time, but my final question for both of you, of course, when she comes back, but Mark, you can answer this first. What have you learned about yourself during this time staying at home?
Well, you know what? I've learned that I like taking things day to day and not worrying about things beyond that. I've learned that I like moving slower in life. I've learned that I need to work a little more on being caring and considerate, and I've had the time to become more aware of that.
Yeah.
You know, we're so driven, especially in this industry, especially doing something like theater, where we are, you know, we're racehorses and we're out of the gate.
Yeah.
You know, I've learned that there are things that I'm finding about being in this environment that I want to keep with me, even when we're no longer in this environment. I like the quiet. I like the carefulness and the consideration of this time.
Yeah.
And I want to try to carry it even when we're back and moving forward and forgetting that this ever happened.
Beautifully put. Jeanette, my last question was, what have you learned about yourself with being home during this stay-at-home time?
Oh man, what did I learn about myself? I know that I feel like I'm a little more sensitive towards just people and their mental state. Because I'm a pretty strong person.
Yeah.
You know, it's not too many things are gonna rock me. And I feel like during this time, like there are just so many ups and downs. And you know, I definitely felt like, wow, this is something that, like, I didn't know that this would have this effect on me, because some nights I can't sleep because you especially if you're watching the news and you're just thinking about people suffering and can't breathe, it just takes a toll on you. And I feel like I'm much more sensitive about mental health now. Because I understand that, you know, people deal with things differently. And because usually I'm like this rock, like this right here was something that literally had me like, oh my goodness, the thought of people suffering. And I know people suffer all the time, but when it's in your face all the time and you're just seeing all these images and you're just thinking and you just want to help, but you can't do anything but stay home. You know, it's like, because I'm a fixer too. Like, oh, I'm like, oh, well, I can solve this problem. I can solve that problem. But having to like stay home and just not be able to solve the problem. I mean, we're staying home, so that's helping, but you don't really feel the effects of it because you're just home.
Yeah.
So I feel like I'm a little more sensitive. I'm more sensitive now to mental health, because there were points where I'm like, wait a minute, I can't sleep. And I find myself, and I'm waking up and I feel like my body is tense. It's because I'm so tense. I'm going to sleep like this. That was early on. And so, realized that there were things that I had to do for myself to calm me down and keep me at a place of peace. So, and that's just what I've been trying to do. Like, I'll make videos, singing songs and just talking to bring peace, because I understand this is not, what we're going through is not easy. This is not easy. We are going through a lot as a world. And, we need our spirits to be lifted. And I know the importance of that, because I needed it for myself. So,
well, I want to thank the two of you. Like I said, I have known Kudisch forever. Yeah. Jeanette, I saw you as Steely, just so you know. I saw you in Color Purple. So, I mean, I was there for, you know. But, I mean, what's really great is that you sit here with me, and I've had a lot of, you know, stars and cast of other shows that have just shared what they're going through right now and connecting with them and connecting with the fans. So I really want to thank you. This show that you do, I mean, I have my opening night playbill here somewhere. I cherish this. My opening night, Girl from the North Country. Yes. Your show is so heartfelt. Like I said, I wish you could step out of yourselves and see what you give on stage to people. I cannot wait to be back there to see your show, when it kicks back up, when you go back up 8 times a week. I, like many other people, are going to be there just to get re-nurtured by what you all give us. So I want to thank you for that, number one. And for our audience watching, you know, if anybody in the audience is considering maybe making a donation to the Actors Fund, also consider BroadwayCares.org, because it's during this time period that Broadway Cares would raise close to over $6 million during this six weeks, which they don't have right now. Mm-hmm. But what they have, Broadway Cares, is they have their online COVID-19 Emergency Assistance Fund online. They have raised $2 million, which they have given to the Actors Fund. That's as of today. They have raised this online. So, and it's all what you all do. So, like I said, thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here with me and doing my live at home virtual edition. You two are flawless. Your show is great.
Thank you.
For our audience, tune in again Friday, because I'll have some of the stars of the Broadway musical Moulin Rouge back here at 12.
Yay.
Listen, stay safe, both of you.
You stay safe. You've been talking to us all afternoon, and we've had no time to actually talk to you about your own experience here. But at the very least, I'd like to say it's good to see you. Yeah. Thanks for doing this. Thanks for keeping all of us connected this way, Rich. It's really important
now. Thank you.
Well, it means the world to me. Thanks. Have a great day, everybody. Stay safe and wash your hands.
See you in a minute, Jeanette.
Bye.